Fourth step is composed of four parts. Those four parts are, first, our resentments. Second, the catalog of our own wrongs and a look at the people we've harmed. Third, our fears list. And fourth, the part we're looking at tonight is our sex inventory. Now, please keep in mind that the fourth step is designed specifically for us to identify and to uncover the cardinal defects of resentment, dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. The same defects we find in the 10th step and again in the 11th step. And these defects are specifically identified and set out for us in each of the... Peter, do you have a question?
Yes, yeah, Jim, I think we finished on page 67. I think we just got done with our people who harmed us. Part one, resentment. I don't think we've done fear or anything else like that.
Really?
Yeah.
Anybody else remember? Well, that's okay. Then we'll go back and okay. So we just got through with resentments last week, huh? How, I just wanted to get in that sex inventory. I guess we got to save that for next week, huh?
This is how fast you are.
I think we all ought to hiss and boo Peter. He just took away all our fun. Everybody get a resentment against Peter tonight. Well, having been so forcefully and duly directed, however, I'm not there yet, Peter, so bear with me, okay? Remember that the fourth step is designed to accomplish five major objectives. First, a proper fourth step will result in us being set free from our resentments, the ones we carried in here with us. It does not mean, of course, that resentments won't crop up again. But anything we brought in with us, if we do it right, we're set free from them. And we talked about that last week. Second, the fourth step properly done will begin the process of setting us free from our fears. Third, the fourth step properly done will give us an ideal for our future relationship life, our future sex life, with God's help. Fourth, we have a list of all the people we've harmed and we've become willing to make amends to them, set matters straight. In other words, in the fourth step, we will actually accomplish most of our eight-step list. And number five, we'll have a list of our defects of character, which is that list that we carry forward with us into the fifth step. Now, when we did our resentments, remember that we did not look at our own faults. Remember that in the big book, the steps as originally written, the steps which have been responsible for millions of recoveries, do not compare our fault with others or their fault with ours. Comparative fault is not a part of the big book. It's something which we find in other literature and in other 12-step groups, but not here. And so now we're going to need to look at our own faults, and we're going to need to look to see whom we have harmed. Remember that the fourth step is designed for us to find out what's wrong with us. It is not designed to indict us or make us bad or wrong. It's designed for us to find out what our present reality is so that we can begin to deal with that on a current basis today, and not be living in the past or wishfully daydreaming about the future any longer. And so to do that, we have to go to the past, and we have to do some very intense work in order to dig up the truth about ourselves. Remember back there in the beginning of chapter 5 where we were reading, what is the bottom line here of recovery? It is the willingness and the ability to be honest with ourselves. Because those who cannot be honest with themselves can't recover. And in this fourth step, we've got a clear example of this self-honesty. In other words, we are divorced from self-delusion, from rationalization. from running away, from denial. And we get right down to brass tacks. In the vernacular of my father, we look to see how the cow ate the cabbage. And we're going to write that down. But this does not mean that our four-step is a fearsome thing which is meant to indict us, to make us wrong. It's meant for us to find out what is wrong so that we can go to God with it and have it corrected. Remember what we're looking for here, guys. We're looking for those defects of character over which we have no power. We can't get rid of them ourselves. Back there in the third step, we already examined our selfishness and self-centeredness. And what did the big book tell us? It told us that we couldn't be rid of our selfishness ourselves. We had to have God's help. And just last week, as we were studying the remedy for our resentments, what did we find? The big book told us that we are as powerless over our resentments as we are over alcohol. We can't wish them away any more than we could wish away alcohol. So what we see here is this is an aspect of powerlessness which is not often talked about, but it's here in the book and it exists with you and me. It's a reality that we have to deal with. Our powerlessness extends to our defects of character, which means quite simply that when we start talking about, oh, I'm working on my defects, I always have to ask the person, how do you do that? If you're powerless over your defects, tell me how you work on them. And the reason we're powerless, this is something else that you and I have discussed a number of times, but let's make sure we understand it. These defects of character are the natural God-given instincts warped and perverted by fear. Instincts for sex, security, and society. Now, being instincts, they operate below the level of conscious thought, and because they do, we don't have any conscious control over them. Think about it. Do you consciously have to urge yourself to want to be a part of a group, to not be excluded, or do you just simply react that way? Because it's natural that we want to be included, we want to be liked, we want to be thought kindly of, we don't want to be excluded or shunned. We'll do almost anything sometimes to assure our place within a society. Well, how about sex? Do you have to will yourself to become interested in somebody sexually? No, it just happens. Just stop and think about it. These are not things over which we have control. Therefore, it gets real simple once you follow it through. We have no power over our defects because they are instinctual. And by definition, an instinct operates below the level of conscious thought. We can will ourselves to not take certain actions. But that doesn't mean the defects aren't still there. Ladies, we have some chairs up here if you'd like to come up and sit down. You happy there? Okay. You're very ornamental, I must say. That's very nice. A lot prettier than that picture behind you. Okay, that's enough of this frivolity. So, when we look at our natural instincts and we look at our defects and we recognize that they are one and the same, and then we understand that why it is we have no power over them, we cannot get rid of them ourselves, and we need God's help. That's why we have to find them. We must first identify them, and then we take them to God and ask Him for help. So tonight, then, we're going to begin on page 67, the second full paragraph, which commences in the middle of the page. Now, here's what we have so far, guys. We've got a resentment list. And that list is composed of names of a number of people. 3, 4, 5, 10, 15, 40, 100. It doesn't matter, however it turned out for each one of us. But that list of people now becomes a list that we're going to again refer to, only so that we can identify the people we're going to be writing about in terms of ourselves. And so it says in that center paragraph, referring to our list again, that is our reexamined list. Putting out of our minds the wrongs others had done, we resolutely looked at our own mistakes. Now it's important again for us to understand the sense in which this big book is written. You notice it does not say, you must now refer to your list again and you must put out of your mind the wrongs that others have done you and you must resolutely look at your own wrongs. It's not what it says. Why? Go back to basics again, so because it's so important to understand what this big book is doing. The forward to the first edition tells us that we are more than 100 men and women who have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body to show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered is the main purpose of this volume. So that's what they're doing here. This book was written to show us how those who came before us recovered from this seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. And that's why it is written as we. A we does not mean we did all this together. It means we, each of us, did this separately. Because ultimately this all comes down to each of us individually between us and God. And when people talk about this being a we program, we're not going to use this as an example of we-ness. Not in the sense that for example, can you imagine what chaos it would be if we all did our fifth steps at the same time? Or try to do our four steps at the same time? No, that's not what it means at all. And so it's telling us that putting out of our minds the wrongs others had done, we resolutely looked at our own mistakes. See, what they did here was they knew that you could not profitably mix the two. Over here, these folks did all these things to me, and yes, well, of course, I did these things to them, but no wonder I did them. Look what they did to me. Comparative fault. Got it? Comparative fault. There is no such thing in the big book. It does not exist in the big book. It exists only in some fringe stuff that's sitting out there, or maybe over in other fellowships, but not here. Because now we've got to put the spotlight on ourselves. Remember that the four-step in the big book is a four-step which does not go after things with a broadsword. It's with a rapier. It goes right to the point. Now, what is the point going to be here? The point of this second part of the four-step is to find out about three defects of character. Dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. Where's resentment? Well, we already took care of resentments, didn't we? We did those last week. Well, 2 weeks ago. And then last week. We proceed at a snail's pace around here, guys. If you're brand new, don't worry about it. We managed to get through somehow or another. And so now the big book is directing us to look at ourselves and to identify our selfishness, our dishonesty, and our fear. And also we are being asked to demonstrate our selfishness by identifying our self-seeking actions. But it all comes back to self, doesn't it? Therefore, nothing else may be allowed to interfere with this because we cannot blur the edges. We've got to come out with a clear definition and exposition of our defects of character in widescreen Technicolor stereo and Dolby so that there's no question about them. Got to be like on the Ginza in Tokyo, everything bright lights and it's all flashing at one time and saying, Now when we do it this way, that's the way it comes out. Bill, when he wrote these steps, and he later had spoke of it often and wrote about it, he said, I needed to write these steps in a way that there was no mistake about what it is we needed to do, because he said alcoholics are always going to try to find another way. He said, I wanted to make sure that there was no wiggle room. that you could not get away from the meaning. Because after all, what would be the point of them telling us what they did and they recovered if we said, aha, well, that's okay for you guys, but we're going to go out and find our own way to do it. And common wisdom around these rooms, at least the politically correct AA these days, almost comes down to a kind of a laissez-faire. Do the steps any way you want, doesn't matter as long as you do them and that kind of stuff. Well, that's okay if that's what you want to do, but that's not what the big book says. And millions of people have recovered using what is here and what you and I are studying together. Why in the world would we want to go anywhere else? Some counselor at some out-of-the-way treatment center who wrote a four-step guide or something, would you want to trust that, or would you rather go back and pick up the steps that have been used by millions to recover? I think the answer to that ought to be obvious. And so, we're resolutely looking at our own mistakes. Where had we been selfish? Where had we been dishonest? Where had we been self-seeking? Where had we been frightened? Now let's see how this works. Let's assume that we get our four-step resentment list and it's right in front of us. Now who's first on that list? Let's say the first one on that list is Papa. There's Papa. Okay. Now let's go down here and let's see what questions we're going to answer and how we're going to answer them. Here's what it tells us to do. With respect to Papa, question number one, where had I been selfish in my relationship with Papa? Now where doesn't mean was I, it means where was I, which means that we're going to write a narrative description of our selfishness in our relationship with Papa. That's question number one. Question number two, with respect to Papa and my relationship with Papa, where had I been dishonest? And now I'm going to write a narrative description of my dishonesty with Papa. Question number three, with respect to my relationship with Papa, where had I been self-seeking? In other words, what actions of self-absorption and self-seeking had I taken in my relationship with Papa? Question number four, with respect to Papa, where had I been afraid? And we're going to describe the fears that may have been the result of our relationship with Papa. Now, if in fact we had none of these things, then of course we answer no, or I didn't do this, or it's not applicable, anything you want to put down. But in most cases, we're going to find that resentments are reciprocated, that the actions that others took which caused us to be resentful, we reciprocated those actions in one form or another. So usually we'll find that we have equally acted toward others, the ones we resented, acted or reacted to them in ways that will identify our defects. And then finally, it goes on to say, though a situation had not been entirely our fault, we tried to disregard the other person involved entirely. Please, that means exactly what it says. This is not about them. It is not about comparing with them. It is not about us saying, well, yes, I know I did that, but I definitely feel as though I was driven to it by his actions or her actions. We don't do that. We're not going to soften the blow any here. Why? Because you see, it's not a question of indicting us. It's not a question of making us bad. It's a question of finding out what's wrong with us. It is through this review of our past that we are able to identify our defects of character that are killing us. They're eating us alive. They're cancers. They're causing our failures in life. They're causing our drinking or our drugging or both. This is why we have to find them. And our job that we took on when we did our third step and we asked God to take our life and our will into His hands, we committed ourselves to go forward with these steps. We committed ourselves to make a strenuous effort to find so that we can be rid of the things in ourselves which are blocking us from God. That's exactly what we're doing here. Nothing more, nothing less. None of this is intended to act in a pejorative manner toward any of us. And when we begin to deal with it from a practical, pragmatic standpoint, we find that the only way we're going to be able to identify the things in ourselves which block us from God is to get down and dig around here and find out what went on in the past, because that's the only guidepost that we have. But it's a good one. It always works if we'll do it. And then the next question, question number 5, where were we to blame? Aha, this is a very, very important question. And let's see why. One of the things that we're doing here in this 4-step is identifying the wrongs and the harm that we've done others. Why? Because it is in the 4-step that we're going to construct our 8-step list. It is here that we are to determine what we have done which was harmful to others. It is here that we're not only going to identify the wrongs and the harm we've done to others, but we're going to become willing to set matters straight. In other words, we're going to accomplish our 8-step as we do our 4-step. You have any doubts about that? Let's just look over briefly on page 70, down to the bottom of the page. 4 lines up in the bottom of page 70. We have listed the people we have hurt by our conduct and are willing to straighten out the past if we can. 8-step list. Okay. So the inventory was ours, not the other man's. When we saw our faults, we listed them. We placed them before us in black and white. Now, of course, this inventory all inventories are in writing. Oh, I suppose if you had a store that carried only one brand of shoes, and you only had one shoe in each size, and one shoe, and all those had one color and one style, maybe you could just go count the shoes, and that'd be your inventory. But that's about the only way that an inventory cannot be in writing. Well, our inventory, as complex as it will turn out to be, must be in writing, and each inventory we do from now on must be in writing. And we have to learn this very, very important principle of action. And I reduce it to a little ditty, if you don't mind, Nick. The more you write, the better you feel. The more you write, the better you feel. We write and we write and we write and we write. And this is a good place right now in the 4-step to find out how to do that, to find out you can do it, to find out that when you do it, it works. But mainly, we don't talk during meetings. You got something to talk about, girls, you talk to me. Sorry about that, kids. You just left yourselves wide open over there. Okay, so now what we're looking at then is a situation where we're going to write this down, and in writing it down, we have accomplished a significant part of the commitment that we made when we did our 3rd step. That is to find. We made a commitment to find out what it is that's blocking us from God. And right here in our 4-step, that's what we're doing. And then we made a further commitment to do those things necessary to be free of what's blocking us from God, because our pursuit here is to fit ourselves to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. To do that, we must be free from the things that block us from Him. We must be in the world of the Spirit, we must be God conscious, we must have a spiritual awakening. In order to do that, we have to go through this whole process of the steps. Notice that we admitted our wrongs honestly and we're willing to set matters straight if we can. Please, this, by the way, is going to carry over into our 5th step, because a part of our 5th step is going to be composed of our admission of the wrongs and harm that we've done others. We get it out, not just on paper, but we articulate it, because, you see, That wrong and that harm that we've done others has caused us great shame and pity, great shame and remorse, and that blocks us from God just as surely as our defects do. Shame and remorse block us just as much from God as our defects, and we have to be free from them. And our way we get free from shame and guilt is through the ninth step. It is in the making of amends that we are shriven of our guilt. And when that happens, that removes the last things that are blocking us off from the sunlight of the Spirit. And right here in the fourth step is where we find out what we have done, which needs to be amended by us. So you can see how very, very important that is.
All right, everybody, can you find a seat? Enough fooling around at this meeting already, correct? My name is Steve, I'm an alcoholic. We have anniversaries tonight. And first anniversary of 1 year is Mark. Is Mark here tonight? I didn't think so. Let's give him a round of applause. Oh, I know this girl's there. And we have Roberta with 1 year.
All right.
Jody.
Where's Jody?
She's coming. There she comes.
You got to show me. Oh.
I've known Roberta probably 9 to 12 years of my sobriety. I've seen her fall, and I've seen her pick herself up and brush herself off and start again. And I must say that it's great to see what sobriety does in people's lives when they get it. And I believe that Roberta's getting it. And for the first time in all the 9 years that I've known her, I've seen the light shine in her eyes. And I believe she's willing to live it, and that's what it's all about. And I love her to death, and she is one of a kind. And she's definitely been blessed. And I hope she continues on with great work with her sponsor, because I know her sponsor has done a magnificent job showing her the path. And I think that's what it's about, the sponsorship. And part of it, anyway, a good part of it. With 1 year of sobriety, Roberta.
You got other people in there who want to hear you. They can't hear you without the mic.
Marilyn's job. She likes to act.
Just take the microphone.
Stick it up where?
Where you usually do it.
We know each other long enough where I can say that. Hi, I'm Roberta. I'm an alcoholic and mad. I've been around these rooms since 89, and there are some people in this room that have known me since then, and I'm staring at one of them, and he's seen me through a lot of trials and tribulations in sobriety, and you don't have to be out there drinking and drugging for a life to happen and create total insanity for you. But what I have done in the past is I have let it get to me. I've gotten on pity pots. I have stayed in my shit. I've talked about changing. I haven't. And I had some time, and I had some good time. And thank God I had the wisdom to know the difference, that I had to get myself back into a medical detox. But I don't believe anything changed after that with my program. And this time around, it's been the toughest year of my life in all the years I've been around rooms. And I finally got enough emotional and spiritual pain, and I knew I had to make changes. And I finally had the courage to share about it at a meeting, because I was new to the 101 Club, I was new in the area. And I finally reached out to somebody who is now my sponsor, who I call every day. Everything he tells me to do, I do. Every single suggestion this man has given me has helped me. I now have a self-confidence and a self-worth about myself that I haven't had in I don't know how long. And it's not my ego. It's just a feeling that I haven't had in a long time. I never realized how important having God with me at all times, how important it was. And it's not just about saying please in the morning and thank you at night. There's more to it than that. There's more to it than just coming to a meeting. You know, there's action and there's work that needs to be done during the day. And it makes me feel so good when my sponsor tells me I am doing a good job. And when people like my best friend Jody tell me that they see the change in me, I'm starting to feel it. And for the first time in my life, I'm starting to see the light at the end of the tunnel, or glimmers of it. And it's because I am finally ready to do the legwork. I have no more excuses. And I know that if I keep God with me, and I keep writing, and I keep journaling, and I keep reaching out for help, I'm going to make it. And I have a lot of good friends in this room. I know people, there's a young lady sitting in front of me who I joke around with all the time, who saw me through one of my relapses. And it's an honor and a privilege to be back up here again. And I just have all of you to thank. My friends, my sponsor, and God for carrying me through everything that I have and not having me fall on my face every time I thought I was going to. I've just been able these past 6 months to pick myself up and know what the right thing is to do. And it does come from the Big Book sponsorship and having a support group. And I am so grateful to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, Jim got these special codes on these cards. You forgot to tell me about. I'm always the last person to know. Here you go, Jim.
Okay, guys, I got somebody who's got to give a die to tonight. And I say I got to, but if I don't, you'll kill me. This guy with a ball of fire, I'll tell you that. She is something else. But she got a great attitude. She got a wonderful attitude about her program. She has found God of understanding. She stays close to that fellow upstairs. Everything I tell her to do, she says, well, maybe. but she's been doing a wonderful job. Just kidding. She's a beautiful, beautiful girl, and she has a personality that won't quit. And I love her to death. And she just moved over on the beach, but. But it's way, 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 way up there somewhere in cabbage patch. Somewhere. I don't know. I tried to find it one day and I got lost. I've been around here for a long time. Anyway, Linda, love you. Come on up and get your money in the bag.
Supporting someone else who needed help, and I sat down with her afterwards and I said, you know, Greg, I said, you need to look at something, and I think you need to look at your alcohol intake and your problem. And she looked at me like, that's not why I'm here, you know? And well, she took what I said and she started to work. And she got into the program and looked at herself, and she's been a light for many, many people. She's helped many, many women in this program and some men. And she continues to do that. She's a light for God. And I'm just so proud to be here tonight to present her with this 10-year medallion.
By the way, that's how it works. Someone helping someone else out. And I couldn't believe, you know, like a decade, wow, 10 years. And I looked back and I thought about, you know, it just doesn't seem like that long. And I've been able to enjoy sobriety through like the birth of a lot of dreams and the death of a lot of dreams and some great stuff and some bad stuff and some tragic things. And Bob's been there with me through it all. And I was thinking, you know, what profound thing could I be sharing with you guys? And God brought me here, and God is leading me in this program as well as outside this program. And I'm becoming more and more a person that is connected spiritually and, as Jim always says, fit for doing God's work. And that's what it's about for me today. And it's just like one day at a time, all of a sudden 10 years or 11 or 2 or a month happens. And I have to learn that every day. And my sponsor helps me with that. Because I always still want to project forward and go faster than God wants me to go, or lag behind. But one day at a time, I stay in step, and sometimes 1 minute at a time. And I have to be reminded about this. I'm still learning how to do it. And I haven't arrived by any means, and never will. But what a great and fantastic journey that I've had so far. And I'm going to be starting over again on the 12 steps again, which I think is really apropos in my second decade starting. So that's what I'm going to do, just to readdress new things and the new person I am today from 10 years ago. So it's great seeing all of you here. I was like, I came in, I was like, wow, look at all those people that came just to see me get out of town. Right?
Right.
God bless you all. Thank you.
Jim, I think this one has your name on it too, that secret code.
With pleasure. Well, we have a lady here tonight who crossed the border some time ago from Canada. And she still has quite a bit of the Canadian in her and quite a bit of the French in her, and she dresses like the little blonde doll from the from Paris, beautiful lady. She has helped so many people, and continues to do that. There are some people who are in our books. Bill writes about them, and people who have very serious problems in their lives, and yet they don't give in to whining and mewling and sniveling or self-pity. They keep a smile on their face. They continue a very positive frame of mind. And in doing that, they're able to continue to carry the message and help other people. This is a lady who is the godmother of this group. At one time, we used to have a feast here every night. She used to make up 3 or 4 platters of sandwiches. We had to bribe people to come to this group at first, you know, and they'd sneak in here and have dinner and leave. But after a while, they started to catch on, and they started sticking around, didn't they, honey? You know, it was wonderful. At one meeting, we had 180 people here. All 3 rooms were absolutely loaded. And Janine silently went, and then there were a whole bunch of other things too. I don't know what, cakes and cookies and all that stuff. But that's Janine. And you know, when she makes a commitment, she lives up to it. She decided to put this group together, and she did it. Thank God she did it. I think this is the strongest group in town. I'm absolutely certain of that. And I'll tell you why. The people who come to our groups on Saturday, our 3 groups, our 3 meetings, are here for the big book and God and the steps of recovery. And we're not messing around with Problems Anonymous and all that other stuff. We get right down to it. We get right down to recovery. And you know, it's not everybody who wants that. I honor you folks for being here on Saturday night. I really do. Thank you for that. And Janine, thank you, Durham, for having gotten all this started, for supporting it, for being there, for being the wonderful person that you are. Please come up and get your 23 in the house.
Jean, I'm an alcoholic. You can't touch me. Oh, 23 years ago when I came here, I never forget, I sit over there. I don't sit there anymore. And Ray Allen was sitting over there, and my husband said, you better come in A or I'm in. So he took me here, and I did speak too much English at that time. And he said, well, you have to read the big book like Jim. And I said, well, I can read English. And he said, well, get a dictionary. So that's what we were talking earlier. So anyway, it was a long road, real long. I was very attracted when he was talking about God. I wanted so bad, and I was so arrogant. I was arrogant, selfish, self-centered, and it was me, 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 me. And he said, you know what? I don't know if you're going to make it. You better work the first step and look at it. And I thought, oh my God. I said, but I don't know what it's mean. He said, well, keep coming, keep coming. So every day, we'd be at the door at 8 o'clock and waiting till the door opened at that time. And this place was really small. We had one bathroom when we start, and after that, they built another bathroom. They built a recovery room in the back, and it's amazing. You know, Ray was deaf a little bit, and he used to have some hearing aid, and every time I wanted to talk to him, he didn't understand anything anyway. So he turned it off, so I was talking to myself. And I keep talking, talking, and boy, he passed away last year, and it was a big part of my life. But you know what? God replaced him with Jim. And Jim has been a lifesaver to all of us here. I think he's such a special person. I learned so much from just listening to him. And you know, the wisdom that he have. Not too many people have that. That intellect, you know, knowing the book by heart. Doesn't matter how long you have in the program, I think it's from the grace of God, and he's got a gift. And I'm so grateful that when I saw him the first time, he said, oh my God, we need him. We really need him. And I asked him, you know, if you want to come over and if you like to do the step. And he's, every time I ask him, said, yes, yes, never refuse. And, you know, it was really a miracle and a blessing in the sky. We call this place here the Miracle of Dixie at the beginning. And I wish we kept that name, but the name went away. We changed it to another name, but so what? Still the Miracle of Dixie. Because I see people here, I don't see too many at the time when I came here. But I see people for many, many years. Good friend, who touched my life. A lot of people here who touched my life, especially those, that little gang over there. And another little gang here. I know Linda for many, many years. And it's amazing, you know, what you can go through in the program, and you can keep your spiritual awakening every day, every day. Like last year, you know, my husband had an open heart surgery. Ray passed away, my sponsor that I used to have. After that, my dog, and I was diagnosed for cancer. So I've been going through cancer for a year. Ding, ding, 35 radiation, one breast, the other breast, the other. It's like they're playing ping pong. And I said, oh my God, I said, you know, this is getting to be a little bit too much. So finally they decide, well, we'll take care of that. So that's gonna be next month. So anyway, I'm grateful that, you know, by the grace of God, that I'm sober. I have no excuse to drink and drug. Doesn't matter what, you know, you go through in life. And the people who pick up the medallion and the new people who are here tonight, I'd like to congratulate you and to keep coming back, because this step is a way of life, happy, joy, and free. No matter what you're going through of life, this is life. And I've still been married with my husband 26 years. So we're still in love, happy, joy, and free, and life goes on. Only by working step, and it's amazing, you know, what somebody just said, that it's like being reborn again. Every day it's like being reborn again. And if you don't focus on the negative, think positive and try to meditate, even if you don't, I didn't know how to pray when I came here. Today my conscious contact is every day, every day. I go with the spirit within, and I don't ask for winning the jackpot or having a new home. I'm grateful for what I have, not what I want. And it's amazing how much God put people in our life, and they touch us. If it wasn't for this program, I don't know, I don't think I'd be here, and I don't think a lot of us will be here, because this is a blessing from God. And I'd like to thank you all for being here. And Jim, thank you so much, and I love you much, much, much.
You know, I told Janine that I was going to say some nice things about her, but she better say some nice things about me, too.
Well, I'm back again, and I think it's almost a nice way of closing time, huh, Jim Wallace?
No.
No. You know, this meeting's a little different than normal meetings.
Yeah.
It's a little unorthodox.
Yeah, well, let's go ahead and close. Let's give her plenty of time to do her thing.
But, you know, that's what makes this meeting so good, I think. We do things a little different. But then again, we have Jim that takes her out of the big book the way it's supposed to be done. You know, I remember trying it all different ways, the softer and easier way, and until I met Jim and did it, steps out of the big book, then finally the light came into my eyes. But with that, I'll turn it back over to Jim.
Thanks a lot, Steve. Let's see, I guess it's a little bit late for us to get started with Spears List, so we're going to do that next week, but we've got plenty of time now that that Marilyn, she's got a whole, do you have a new script, or? By the way, I want to remind you that following this meeting, sometime after 9 o'clock, we're going to be back there in the clean room, and we're going to be doing our Language of the Heart meeting, and we've got a really great topic tonight, and invite all of you to show up. I think I know you'll enjoy it. And next week we will have our little business meeting. That's not a bloodshedding contest. It lasts about 5 or 10 minutes. Main thing is to find out what Marilyn's done about with our money. We do have to decide whether to give any money to area and district this month. That might take some difficulty. Other than that, I want to thank all of you so much for being here, and I'm going to ask Marilyn now to come up and do the chips.
We have the chip system, and the chip system, I think it's very apropos.
Why is that?
That we have visitors from Atlantic City, because, which I love very much. I met them this morning. I love these women. But anyway, we use poker chips. To symbolize lengths of sobriety in the first year. And the chips symbolize the fact that you are gambling with your lives if you pick up a drink. And let me tell you something, the odds are really bad. In fact, they're invariably fatal if you pick up a drink. So, not only that, but the chips are red, white, and blue.
Why is that?
Which show which is like the freedom. Freedom from bondage of self, which we do attain.
Yes.
If we work these steps. And we have a white chip.
What color?
It's white.
White?
Yeah.
How white?
How
white is
it? Oh, and by the way, not only is it white, and it's all white to pick up a white chip, by the way, but also, chips are round. Chips are round like the letter O. Like the number of drinks you're supposed to drink if you pick this up. Oh. They're also round like the O in hope. And in hope, the HPE stands for higher power is everything. Would anyone like to pick up a white chip and join us on the road to happy destiny?
If you're not afraid, just come on up.
In other words, if you want to start off, you can pick up a white chip. All right. Oh, oh, I found out something extremely interesting.
No,
nobody wanted one. I found out something extremely interesting about the red chip.
Uh-oh.
Do you know why it's red? Because by the time you get 3 months, you better have read the big book. So, has anyone earned 90 days, 3 months? Come on down. Okay, then we have a blue chip.
What color?
Well, what it's color? Blue. But you know what? Having this blue chip is like having yourself some shares of blue chip stocks in your pocket. And you know, the returns are excellent if you work the steps. Has anyone earned 6 months of sobriety blue chip tonight? Okay.
What's the matter with you guys? You get a hug if you come up here.
Okay, then, last but not least, Jim has formulated these little silver medallions. He has actually taken Budweiser cans, and he has a special formula where he melts them down and he punches them into these little 9-month chips. Has anyone earned a 9-month silver medallion?
With Bill and Bob.
You with Bill and Bob. He's turned Bud into Bill and Bob. Anybody? Okay, no. All right, listen, did you guys enjoy our little whoopee party tonight for the January Sovereigns? Congratulations to all the January Sovereigns. Whoopee. Do you know that the word whoopee party is found on page 101 in the big book? That's why the club is named the 101 Club. Just a little bit of history for you. Anyway, is anyone celebrating in the month of February? The love month. Yes. What's your name and how many years?
Rob Seven.
Rob Seven. One. What's your name?
Mara.
Oh, Mara. I'm sorry. I didn't see you. Sorry.
I got another one here.
I don't have my glasses on. Steve? Steve? Yes. How many years?
32.
32. All right. Now, what kind of a whoopee party is that going to be? 32 years. Woo.
Get them some lemon, Kool-Aid. Make it a Kool-Aid party.
Any of you breathing brethren? Any breathing brethren? Yes. Breathing brother, what's your name and how many years?
Steve,
too?
Steve,
too. All right. Another Steve. Okay, semi-breathing brethren over here. No? Oh, okay, you were just pointing to Steve. Okay, good. You got a support system, Steve. Anybody else? Okay. Oh, yes. Oh.
All right.
Oh, fantastic. Woo. Okay, good. So we'll be here the last... Saturday in another whoopee fart. Tell me what kind of cake you want, and I'll see what I can do. Let's talk to the cook. Okay.
Take it
away. Thank you, Marilyn. You know what? Give her a big round of applause. Oh, yeah. She won't keep doing it, doing that, but she don't appreciate it. I asked Marilyn the other day, what does HALT mean, Marilyn? She thought about it.
You're the one that said this.
She said, well, see, that means horny, anxious, left out, and terminal. I said, you're right. Okay, guys, any announcements for the good of AA? Any commercial announcements like bingo parties or whoopee parties or any of that stuff? All right. Then if all of you from the clean rooms will join us. Oh, wait a second. Yeah.
My name's John. I'm an alcoholic.
Hey, John.
February 15th to 16th, there's going to be a 12-step workshop here in the Pompano Beach area. If you'd like some information about that, it's a great way to practice 12 steps of recovery in a group setting. With a sponsor, your sponsor, or a sponsor there, or if you're experienced, you can come and be a sponsor. It's a great way to practice. You know, we don't ride a bicycle the first time we get on it. We get on it, we practice, and that's what this workshop is about. If you'd like to know more about it, I have all the details.
All right. Workshop on the 15th and 16th of next month?
Yes, February, yes.
And your name is?
My name is John.
Come see Jack up here. Okay, let's close the meeting.
Hey, Lauren.
Hi. Good job. Good job. You're it.
Nice. Not the only one that can be shot. Okay, we all hooked up. Let's let this circle represent the unity of our fellowship. Let's have a moment of silence for those who are still suffering. And then we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. And please remember, in the stairway group, we don't say anything after we say Amen. Thank you, Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you all for being here. See you next week.
I can't see.
You do good. Good work, Dave.
I want to catch him before the crowd.
Now you know.